Hello, everybody, and welcome to the AVGL Smite College League. My name is J. Mac Tucker, and alongside me is my partner in crime, Gore Miser. How are you doing today, sir?
Dude, I'm doing great. I'm really excited. The season's starting back up, and I mean, last season we saw some great games. This season, it's looking to start out with some great games as well.
And we're going to be starting off with one of our runner-up players from last season. Mojo Cat has formed himself a new team and is representing St. Joseph's University. They're going against the University of Massachusetts, Dartmouth. First round of bans out have been Sirket, Ratatosker, Thoth, and Nike. And the first picks are Sylvanas so far. What do you think about these picks and bans so far?
Right now, Sylvanas, especially for Season 4, he's skyrocketed up towards the top of the pick and bans just because his utility, really, as a Guardian, has gone up. His healing isn't necessarily the thing that gives him as much anymore, but especially for players like MojoCat, being able to hit that pull, having the setup for his team, being able to shred some protections as well, has definitely made him a top choice.
Yeah, and we've seen other Guardians like Kepri really come into rise right now, but with the Thanatos still open on the other side, I do like the Sylvanas being picked up first as opposed to the Kepri, because as we know, that Thanatos execute can go through Kepri ult, but Zeus has been the second locked-in team, locked-in god for St. Joseph's University. Zeus-Sylvanas, tried-and-true combo all the way back towards the Super Regionals.
Yeah, and Zeus is always going to be one of those gods that has just all sorts of strength just because he can do bursts. Like, I mean, the detonate immediately allows him to turn any squishy target on the other team to dust. And having that picked up, especially in Season 4, again, it's another thing that's been really strong right now.
Indeed it has. We have a slight lobby crash here at the moment. We're getting that reformed up as we speak for the moment. So while we do that, let's talk a little bit about the format of this next of the season that's going on here. So for those of you that are new, this is Season 3 of the AVGL. This is our first day and our first game of the first day, St. Joseph's versus University of Massachusetts of Dartmouth. The way that this season's going to break down is we have a first stage round robin. That's what we're going through now. This is the group stages. So all teams are going to play against each other in this round robin format. At the end of that, we're going to take the number one and two seeds from each division within a conference. And there's a whole mess of that that we'll go into. We're going to take the number one and two from that. So there'll be four teams. We're going to round robin them to seed them inside of our gauntlet, which is where we're going to determine the number one team of each conference. There are four conferences, so we'll have four gauntlets. Four winners. Then we'll take those four teams, the four gauntlet winners, and we're going to pit them against each other in a single elimination best of three to determine which two teams are going to our LAN finals at Hi-Rez Studios. This is going to be a crazy season. You have any early season predictions here?
I haven't seen what they've been pulling out. I mean, obviously a lot of these rosters are looking good. We have some teams coming back. I mean, I think we've been talking about it, the Data Remember coming back for the three-peat. He has been at the top both seasons prior to this, and he has what looks like a relatively all-star roster going back into the this season. So it's going to be really interesting to see. Right now, I'd probably say he's definitely going to make it, or his team will definitely make it into that final bracket, and they might have a little bit of run for their money pushing it to the LAN, though.
Yeah, it's going to be difficult for them. As we mentioned, it is Data Remember squad. Most of them returning. They were the champions last season. This time, it's just Data Remember, Final K, and Dingo Dao coming around. They picked up a new mid laner in Cardiac, and then a new solo laner in Puckum. Puckum missed out his chance of LAN last time around, but picked up this all-star squad and has a very strong tension to move forward for this one. Will they be able to get the three-peat? Only time will tell. We'll see if there's anybody who can stand up against them to go for that. But we're now getting back into the game. The bans have come back through, and the picks are making their way back through again. The Sylvanas, the Thanatos, we'll see, I believe it was the Rom, and the Zeus will be picked up as well on the side of St. Joseph's University. So why is Sylvanas Zeus such a powerful combo?
Again, it's all the setup, like Sylvanas being able to pull, knock up, and shred protections with the fact that Zeus doing a huge amount of burst damage, the control he gets from Chain Lightning, the slow, and of course Detonate just being able to eliminate targets on, essentially for here, University of Massachusetts. Ooh. But on the other side, they're going to have a little bit to be worried about because Thanatos, I mean, right now, Season 4 with Smite, early game is the name, and Thanatos, he fits that to a Q.
Yeah, what Thanatos, what used to be known as the early game assassin, has now found his way to being able to make it into the late stages of the game, but that early to mid game execute, getting them under a percentage HP and guaranteeing a kill if you hit that ultimate is so crucial these days, especially in the late game when it's a 40% threshold on their HP for an execute. 40% is a lot of HP still left on somebody like a Guardian or a solo lane warrior. Uller and Poseidon have been the final pickups here before we're going into this ban stage, and we've seen a big resurgence of Poseidon. Why so?
It's kind of the same reason that you'd see a Zeus. It is the Kraken burst damage, the Whirlpool clear. Like early on, Poseidon gets pressure. He has enough early game clear to allow him to kind of push that lane, especially against someone like Zeus, who takes a little bit longer to get online or needs more help from his jungler. Whereas Poseidon, he can hold his own, and once he hits level 5, I'm going to be looking at Thanatos doing a lot of ganks and Poseidon just looking for a big Kraken. Really, right now, University of Massachusetts are focusing very hard on that early game, but if they can get it and they can make it work and push that to the limits, they will get the lead very early on.
Sobek, Kepri, Hoonbots, and Hercules, all four gods being banned out away in this one. And a very wise ban to take out those two support gods in the Kepri and Sobek by St. Joseph's University. Dartmouth hasn't, UMass has not picked up their support yet. And giving Kepri to them on top of Thanatos, Ra, and Poseidon, any three gods who giving them a second life is a dangerous thing to do. It's a great way to take that away. And they're going to respond by picking up the Ymir for likely the support role. But, you know, this is Smite. This is Season 4. We could see this Ymir go anywhere. We could see Thanatos solo. We could see Thanatos jungle. We could see just about anything. And I think that's what's so great about the season right now is god roles are still somewhat ambiguous for a lot of these tankier characters and even some of the assassins. But one assassin that we know is not going into this solo lane because this is not Man Ray is going to be that Thor.
Yeah, Thor being picked up, and that's going to be, again, a lot of early game pressure. Thor's passive actually really benefits him in fights early on. So right now, St. Joseph's possibly looking for some invades with the Vamana on their roster as well. That could potentially spell some trouble for UMass here, but I like the Ymir pickup. In fact, I don't know, like if you follow pretty much every amount of casting I've done since Season 4, Ymir has been one of my favorite gods to watch because the walls have been top-notch. Like they have been out of the ordinary, people making the most clutch saves or stopping or pushing any kind of limit with this wall. And so knowing that play, expecting something kind of similar from UMass here. And I mean, really, their rosters, both sides are looking very strong.
Especially with that last pick, Odin, that has come through. This is purely to shut down this Sylvanas healing, trap that Zeus inside of the cage, and even trap that Vamana who has the healing on his big baby ultimate. Not so much the big baby, just the slightly larger little child, I guess. As we did see the... honestly, I really like the remodel on Vamana. I think it's very nice. But this Odin pickup purely to counter out the Sylvanas, to kill the Zeus, and to trap that Vamana and keep him from healing. Phantom is a relic I'm expecting to see picked up. Almost, if not first, it has to be a second relic.
That's one of those relics that is with Zeus, or with Odin here. You have to pick it up. You either pick it up or you have to accept the fact that some of your teammates are going to be dying. And really, I like the kind of flex that Odin will have here, being able to kind of use that utility, take down targets, trap anybody, control that team fight just a little bit more for their team. But I mean, as it stands right now, both of these teams, they're looking relatively strong. I'm interested to see how this dual lane matchup goes because Uller, relatively higher skill cap, I would say, than Rom, but both of them very auto attack based. Of course, Rom's snipes being one of the, I want to say, harder to hit ultimates in the game, probably one of the hardest. It's going to be very fun. I expect a lot of action just coming through all lanes of this game.
Indeed, we will. But before we do that, we're going to go into a very short break and we'll be back when the game starts. It's going to be our first set of the game, St. Joseph's University against the University of Massachusetts at Dartmouth. We will be right back in just a moment with the start of the game one. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the AVGL College Smite League Game 1 of Day 1. It's St. Joseph's University against University of Massachusetts Dartmouth. My name is J. Mac Tucker, and alongside me is the beautiful Gore Miser. How are you doing?
I'm doing great, and again, this is going to be looking great as minions finally clashing down in the mid lane, and Muffin already taking some damage from the Ymir and the Thanatos.
Ooh, Thanatos taking a big chunk of damage there. Took a little bit of too much minion aggro in the mid lane there. And against a Zeustor, that's not something that you want to do because those are two gods who can kill you off very quickly and very easily in the early. But over in the duo lane, Zetasphere and Mojocat cleared off that wave very early. It is Ulur Sylvanas, so they have a massive amount of wave clear. And they've already taken away the two small minions of the purple buff and the entire red buff. That's going to be very harsh for Sam over there in that duo lane.
And that's really where the pressure we're going to be seeing come out right now, this early game pressure, because the Ymir is sitting in that mid lane. Zetasphere, Mojocat control this side of the map. And because of that, they're not only able to get that and get that little bit of experience from the smaller minions in the camps, but they're also going to be able to steal away this purple buff and potentially the red buff. They already stole away the red buff. So they've pretty much gotten everything they need to on this side of the map, except for the fact that we just saw UMass pick up those left-hand harpies.
Yeah, and they still have their two buffs to go after this, and in fact, they might actually make their rotation over towards the Oracle Harpies, a new jungle boss that has been introduced as of Season 4 in Smite. Getting control of these gives you vision over that Gold Fury pit, but they're not going to go do it. Looks like they're just going to head over and safely do their red buff for now, which that would have probably been the perfect opportunity for them to do those Oracle Harpies. There's three in mid lane that had really no desire to make their way over there at the time, and they had that entire left side of the jungle cleared out.
While on the right-hand side, we're seeing some fights over the elementals, and they will ultimately go towards University of Massachusetts here right now. Sueno jumping around with happiness at his team, getting that little bit of experience and honestly having a little bit of control, but he's losing it overall, still getting some poke down, the minions being pushed into his way, so he's going to lose a little bit of gold, but ultimately I feel like he's coming out as a nat high.
Great pull by Mojo Cat's going to lead into the detonate chain lightning for Muffin, and that's going to be first blood going over to St. Joseph's. Mojo Cat on point with the pulls for the first time around on the Sylvanas.
Yeah, and that's kind of what I expect to see. Booty Call Jones going to get frozen out. Whirlpool going to be good to get some poke down, but it's not enough to find the kill quite yet. And since we didn't see Poseidon tick over to level 5 just yet, he doesn't have that Kraken to throw down. So Booty Call Jones able to get out, but just barely so. If he gets caught in something like that again, he probably won't be walking away with his life.
No, he's going to have to be very careful come to the later portions of the early game in towards the mid stage. He's going to need to really be careful about those whirlpools, especially if he has his hammer still available. He's not going to be able to run away. All he's going to be able to use the damage for that one. We mentioned earlier at the start of the stream that this is Mojo Cat's newly reformed team. So Mojo Cat was the runner-up for Season 2. He went to LAN. His team lost to the Pistol Pete's. Mojo Cat has since split from them and formed a brand new team Meanwhile, Collateral has taken the remaining members of his old team and have formed their own team. And I believe they're in the same conference as well. So later on, up towards the stages of the Gauntlet, we have a chance of seeing the two teams of runner-ups potentially face off for the chance to go to LAN.
Yeah, it's completely a good potential for that. And as it stands, I mean, right now, St. Joseph's are going to see a kill get picked up. Sueno going to fall down, but the rotation's coming out. Typical Java, Harry, Soviet Bear making the rotation. Booty Call Jones might get caught out. He has no mana. He's going to get frozen down. And this is just going to be a lot of damage. This should be a clean kill for University of Massachusetts.
Ooh, the Sanctuary is good to keep him alive just for the time being, but Varix is going to be able to pick him up with that Soul Reef. Meanwhile, Exterminator trying to fight against two of them. Somehow, Typical Java perished in the entire engagement there, which is going to just make this an even one-for-one, actually a two-for-one exchange in favor of St. Joseph's.
I will say St. Joseph's are showing a good amount of experience right now in just how they are farming, because even though some of the jungle camps haven't been going their way, they have a 1,400 gold lead right now, 4.5 minutes into the match. And even though they have those three kills, that's not quite enough to really count for that gold differential. And that is just showing they are doing a very good job of farming and sharing their experience.
Yeah. Mid camp gonna go the way of what looked like UMass Dartmouth, but once again, Mojo Cat on point with his pulls is gonna grab Harry Soviet Bear on that Ymir, and it's gonna be another kill going the way of Muffin. Mojo Cat really strutting his stuff on that Sylvanas right now.
This is the Sylvanas play you want to see. Like, if you ever have a Sylvanas locked in, that's what you want to see. I have not seen him miss a pull yet, and he has been doing the exact right thing at the exact right time. That ultimate, just to lock down Harry Soviet Bear in the Zeus ult, taking that extra bit of damage, really allowed his team to kind of, again, just get ahead. And as long as they find picks like this, they have control of this early game, and now they're leading by almost 2,000.
Yeah, and unfortunately for this Ymir player, Harry Soviet Bear, he's gone with the Reinforced Grief, so he's not going to have the mobility of the Talaria Boots. He's not going to have the gold gain from it. Instead, it's just going to be now putting him just barely about 11 level and a half or so behind right now. He's going to have a hard time getting back into this game if he keeps going like that. Great route by Mojo Cat yet again. Muffin's going to get an immense amount of poke onto Varix in that mid lane. These two, Muffin and Mojo, have been sticking together this entire time and doing exactly what you want. Rooting targets out, pulling them in, poking them down. If you can't kill them, at least you send them back to base.
And they've been doing it at the exact right times as well, as we're seeing another little bit of a poke fest. Sueno going to get knocked up in the solo lane, taking some damage. And here comes Thor, but he's a little bit off the mark. Double tap, not going to connect. Booty Call Jones going to stop, turn to look at Exterminator there, just as an acknowledge of, I can't believe I messed that up. And oof. Unfortunately, what looked like a good kill just completely falls apart.
And meanwhile, over onto the left side of the jungle, those oracles were split 1-1. Typical Java used the Kraken to secure at least one of those away from St. Joseph. So nobody's going to be getting vision of those Gold Fury just at the time, but those will be respawning in the upcoming minutes. Meanwhile, over in the duo lane, we see a Transcendence Rush here by Zetasphere. Did have the Blue Stone, but opted to go into a Transcendence second item.
Exterminator going to get a solo chill there as Varix is going to get taken down. Harry's Soviet Bear erased by Booty Call Jones. And what was a great wall that almost stopped the aggression from being put onto him results in three kills across the board for St. Joseph's. Now they're going immediately for this Gold Fury, and we're actually going to see Zeus throwing down the Storm just to get that extra damage and burst the Gold Fury down before Rom can try and snipe it.
Yeah, that's exactly the reason. So as Sam was in the air, Great Axe is just going to be off the mark from Zeta as he's going to try and rush in to take out Sam. One auto, two auto, third one is not going to connect. Zeta is trying to get it, but Booty Call Jones is going to teleport in, and the spin to win is going to take down Sam. That is the eighth kill of the game going to St. Joseph's.
Right now, the lead being heavily in favor of St. Joseph's, although it's not something that can be forgotten. They can't just start playing like they want to, but they can relax a little bit. Ultimately, right now, their rotations have been very good. They've been making the right calls, and all the solo kills, really, being on the back of Exterminator are kind of what are carrying the right-hand side of the map. We've been looking over there occasionally, but for the most part, the action being over towards that Gold Fury side is what we've seen, and Exterminator being able to hold this lane, much like he is right now, just being able to push out Sueno, has kind of given them a little bit of lax, allowed Booty Call Jones to focus on the mid lane and the duo lane.
Zetasphere, a 2v1 kill, is able to take out Soviet Bear, and that puts him at a 2-0 Uller right now. He's going to be able to back, and I believe he's actually got enough to get his boots, but mid lane skirmish, Muffin takes out Varix with the help of Mojo and Booty Call Jones, and typical Java falls yet again.
Fire Elemental's being saved, Exterminator making sure Booty Call Jones get this, and right now it looks like Booty Call Jones wants some more blood. Sueno gonna be backing under his tower, but I'm not sure Booty Call Jones cares too much. The stun, double tap gonna come through, forcing the shield, and Sueno gonna try to back, but his buff is getting stolen away the entire time, and now more experience on the side, Exterminator getting another lead.
Gold disparity right now sitting at a mere 5,200 gold and only 9 minutes in the game. That is a huge deficit for them for the time being. And if you take a look at the net worth chart for all of these players, the lowest farmed player, which is Muffin on the side of St. Joseph's, is ahead of their highest farm, the solo lane Odin. This is spelling a disaster for them early on in this game, and they're really gonna have to get some good picks and some smart team fights to pull them back into this game.
As Zeta Seer is pushed up, gonna get frozen out by Harry Sylvia Bear, using those purification beads to try and get away. Wall gonna come up, and he looks like he's gonna fight, no, just jumping over, running towards the jungle, knowing where his teammates are making this rotation right now onto Varix, so going to Mojo Cat for the healing and safety that it provides, but the stun gonna be coming down, and Varix wants to go in.
And Zeta's here is going to be able to get the credit for that kill with the last auto attack, but the Kraken and the Whirlpool is going to be enough to take out Zetasphere and shut him down. Meanwhile, Sam and Harry Bear have to split up so they don't get hit by the Chain Lightning. A great job by them by to separate so they don't perish, but I think typical Java himself may be falling here. One more auto and the detonate's going to be enough.
Now we have Sam trying to do anything he can to get a return kill, but he's out of mana, and there are three members strong looking for him. Booty Call Jones going to pick that one up with the Berserker's Barrage. They're going to take away the purple buff just as a little bit extra on top of the cake right now. And, I mean, over on the right-hand side, Exterminator is showing he doesn't need the rest of his team.
No, he's just soloing. He took down that tier 1 tower in the solo lane and is now fighting against Sueno, who is two levels behind and 1,800, almost 1,900 gold behind at the exact same time. Has not been able to finish up that Breastplate of Valor yet, but in the mid lane, another team fight. Booty Call Jones may fall. No, he's going to be able to get out thanks to the sun from Zetasphere. Soviet Bear's going to fall, and Exterminator's going to kill a kill onto Varix between the towers?
That was the level of team play that you want in a game. Knowing Booty Call Jones trusted his team enough to be able to get out. He knew exactly when he had stayed too long, running away, and Zetasphere being able to hit that stun, causing it again, hitting another stun,
Sueno.
And causing Sueno to just get knocked off the map. Two more kills being picked up, the tier 1 in mid, a speed buff taken just for the hell of it, and a surrender vote coming out, and that is going to be a very solid victory for St. Joseph's.
Coming out with a commanding 17-2 victory at only 11 minutes and 19 seconds into the game. Over a 7,500 gold deficit this early into the game. St. Joseph's on a tear at the start of the season.
That was, I mean, just perfect. I mean, they played that exactly how they wanted to. They used their comp the exact way they needed to. Exterminator showing his prowess on this Vamana, being able to get some solo kills, just even when he was being ganked. Booty Call Jones going in, and of course, Zetasphere hitting all of those stuns. And we can't ever forget the support. Mojo Cat hitting as many plucks as he did really allowed his team to get ahead very early on.
One thing that we didn't see out of Mojo Cat last season was those really hot plays. Mojo Cat is a support main. That is his home, is support. When he was on Nodes Gaming last season, he was their jungler, and really his claim to fame as the jungler was Thor. And sure, we saw some pretty nice ganks here and there. We saw some ultimates hit, but overall, Mojo really didn't perform up to that level that he is performing at now, back in his native role, and he's doing a fantastic job on it. Perfect support stats, 0, 0, and 9 on this Sylvanas being a part of only half of the kills, but that's because everybody was soloing. I mean, pretty much any time that there was a fight, Mojo was there.
And what was, I want to say, more impressive with St. Joseph's victory here was the fact that the University of Massachusetts, they weren't playing poorly. They just ended up too far behind. And when you're that far behind, trying to fight typically goes downhill. And unfortunately for Varix there, playing Thanatos, once you fall behind early on, you have to farm. Like, you cannot chase the kills like you want to. Even though you do enough damage, it becomes a lot more difficult for you as a player to kind of have that sort of, like, that comeback. when you are on a Thanatos. The rest of the team might have been able to hold out, but ultimately the experience and the levels just going so far in favor of St. Joseph's that the surrender came out and we ultimately see the victory.
With that, St. Joseph's is going to have the 1-0 lead in this best of three set. We'll be back in just a moment with game two to see if University of Massachusetts can pull out a victory. But only time will tell in that one, and we will be right back. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the ABGL College Smite League. It's day one, game number two of our first set of University of Massachusetts Dartmouth versus St. Joseph's. St. Joseph's is up 1-0 right now, and it's a chance to see if UMass is going to be able to pull it back through.
And what was a very decisive victory for them. Looks like they are trying to change things up on the side of UMass, though Thanatos taken off the board. St. Joseph's not wanting to give up that Sylvanas, going to be taking that one away as well. And so while we wait for this first pick to go in, honestly, Ratatoskr, Thoth, those two are the other bands. And pretty much nothing out of the ordinary. A lot of early game or control. And of course, Thoth, I mean, when he comes up, eventually Desync will just be oozing over Thoth. And Kepri going to be picked up. And that is going to be the early game push that the duo lane is going to need. And honestly, University of Massachusetts, from what they did last game, they're going to need that.
Yeah, and at this point, St. Joseph's might want to try and take away this Izanami, because if you put Iza alongside of Kepri, it's going to be extremely early push in the threat of even the proxy farm that we've seen back behind the Tier 2 tower. But instead, they're going to go back to what they had last game, pick up that Zeus and that Thor, leaving the Kepri open. And they didn't ban away Kepri, because probably either because they didn't fear it, or maybe they weren't expecting it, but because the Thanatos was taken off the board by UMass, they said, hey, now we don't have that threat of an execute, so now we can pick up what we could consider the second best support after Sylvanas.
And St. Joseph's really going back to, I mean, there's always the saying, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And Zeus, Thor, Booty Call Jones played that well, and we saw Muffin perform exceedingly well on the Zeus as well. And it's going to be interesting to see how they fare. Hunbat's being picked up, probably one of the best team fight ultimates in the game on that Fear No Evil. But Nox is something I honestly did not expect to see. And I want to see typical Java, if he can pull out the right combos, Muffin might have a run for his money as to who's going to dominate this mid lane.
I do like the Nox pickup into the Thor, because the Berserker's Barrage is one of the more powerful team fighting abilities that Thor has, obviously being able to stun out as many people as possible. But with the Nox being picked up, he's able to drop that circle, able to drop that on that Siphon Darkness and silence him to where he cannot spin in a circle forever and ever, doing immense amounts of damage to his team. But I do agree. I'm not sure why the Nox pickup. There are lots of other gods that could have been picked up, like Ra or Poseidon, who, as we mentioned, was seeing a recent resurgence. But instead, Nox is going to be the one picked up, as well as Rom going into the bans. What do you think about this next phase of bans?
That's really understandable. St. Joseph's decided to pick up that Rom right before it, and then they ban away the Izanami and the Apollo, the two people who would probably give Rom the most trouble throughout the laning phase, and especially going into the late game. This is something I've seen relatively recently, is that even though Hercules. Rom is difficult early on, if you let him get to late game, he can hit you twice as hard every single time you hit him, and he will definitely be dominating. Whereas with people like Izanami and Apollo, both of them, they hit hard, but right now with the clear they have, they're a little bit more early game focused. They're more about getting ahead, and if they could use that lead on University of Massachusetts, they might have been able to use it, but it looks like Medusa is going to be hovered over. Bologna is locked in, though. I'm actually a big fan of this. I feel like, honestly, we're kind of seeing some Season 2 matchups here with the Bologna versus the Hercules.
Medusa.
Yeah, and seeing the Medusa come back as well. Medusa kind of fell off in Season 3 as the Bluestone Transcendence meta kind of died away. Medusa somewhat fell out of favor. Her damage is a little bit lackluster compared to it. But now she's seeing the recent resurgence because blue buff is a popular item to pick back up on your hunters. I mean, people are favoring, once again, the Bluestone Transcendence. Kind of that late game build is that Transcendence picking up in accordance with the Fatalis, which received its recent buff. These two items being picked up together have been seen quite often. And with the final pick of Xing Chen being picked up here, Mojo Cat, the support, is currently hovering Thor. Are we about to see a role swap back with Mojo in the jungle for this game?
Either a role swap or we are about to experience whatever Xing Chen jungle can pull out on Booty Call Jones. And I'm excited. I think St. Joseph's are maybe feeling themselves a little bit, but Xing Chen's still going to have a lot going for him. Again, teamfight ultimate, if he can get in there, he can round up a couple people and throw them into Muffin's ultimate, getting that damage down on the Zeus. This is looking like another strong composition from St. Joseph's. And UMass, again, they have potential. I can see it in their composition, especially in their players from last game. The question is, can they execute it with this Kepri? I feel like they're going to have a little bit better chance of that going into this game.
Yeah, they're going to have a little bit more mobility and a little bit better CC. While Ymir is not a bad god by any means, does have that wall to block off paths, does have the cone freeze to stun out his enemies. Kepri's got that long-range root, which is going to be able to set up Nox's root, going to have that pull to as well set up as many combos as possible. The Bologna ult with the Hunbat's ult, great team-fighting ultimates, Bologna providing those protections and the power towards her hunter Medusa with another large cone team-fighting ultimate. This is looking like a much stronger synergizing team comp from UMass this time around.
And they're going to have a little bit more advantage as well. The Scourge from Bologna having that silence should help put down a little bit from Zeus, stopping him from getting some charges down onto anybody on UMass, as well as stopping Rom from autoing for at least a few seconds going into the late game, which will stop possibly some crit, maybe just some really hard-hitting autos. Might be able to save a Nox or a Hunbat's here in that opportunity. But the question really is going to be who can pull it out as we just take a short break and go into the next game.
Yeah, and we'll be back in just a few moments with Game 2 of University of Massachusetts versus St. Joseph's.
Face me, coward!
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the ABGL Smite College League. It's the University of Massachusetts at Dartmouth versus St. Joseph's in Game 2 of this best of three set. Last time, St. Joseph's was able to make a commanding 17-2 victory with an 11-minute surrender. Let's see if UMass can bring it back this game.
And this game we do get to see. I mean, Booty Call Jones had a high impact last game. This game, he's looking to have it again on a Xing Qin in the jungle. But right now, Sam in the duo lane already at half health, just showing. I mean, Mojo Cat and Zetasphere with this assassin in the duo lane, he's going to have a lot of extra damage here. And that's going to spell some trouble for the Medusa.
Had to have been a confirmed double tap just free-handed by Mojo to get Sam at that low of HP this early into the game. Not quite sure onto that, but one thing we can be sure of is this speed buff on the bottom side is going to be stolen away by St. Joseph's. And Dartmouth, University of Massachusetts, they have no answer to this. Nox is going to try and make the rotation over, but it's going to be too little too late. Booty Call Jones walking away with a free speed buff.
Right now, Exterminator losing his blue buff and potentially being able to take away Booty Call Jones's speed buff right now. Varix and Sueno making a nice rotation. I like the fact that they made that call to come over here. The Varix walking in a kind of questionable path might get caught out here, getting a little bit of poke for his trouble, but ultimately he should be able to walk away. Zetasphere getting a solo kill over on the left-hand side.
Yeah, that's going to spell First Blood. Once again, kind of caught out and with no minions there, tanking some aggro. And with the power of early game Thor, while he does have a Watcher's Gift, Watcher's Gift isn't really going to deter him that much. Coupled with Zetasphere pumping in a few auto attacks, it's going to spell the First Blood. And honestly, not the best start for UMass right now. They were able to steal away the top side speed in blue, but they've lost their red, their speed, and now their purple buff is being taken away as well.
And they haven't really been able to confirm as much. They just got the left-hand harpies, but the right-hand harpies as well as the elementals went the way of St. Joseph's. And so right now, the map in control fully of St. Joseph's, still even though they lost a couple of buffs. And Sam in this duo lane, not only having that one death on his name, but looking to get another one, sitting at half health again, and he just got back to lane.
Slapbox over in the solo lane. Early game, kind of, it's pretty even between Hercules and Bellona. Both, while Bellona is more auto attack focused, she does have three abilities to get some major damage, but a great pluck and push by the Hercules is going to put Suedo back into the tower, force him to use some of those potions very early on, as he's at critical condition.
Now we're going to see the Oracle Harpies, and now actually the Gold Fury being started up. St. Joseph's looking for this early game damage. Mojo Cat going to take a little bit of poke, but ultimately they're going to be able to confirm that for free, because I don't think anyone on University of Massachusetts expected a 2.5 minute Gold Fury.
Yeah, we can see the pings on the map there towards the purple buff. I think that's what they thought they were doing there, but in reality, it was a free Gold Fury sneak by St. Joseph's University, and that's going to put them up 2,000 gold in the lead to start off this one. Little questionable ult by Booty Call Jones there in the mid lane is only going to fling a few minions, but Mojo Cat getting a kill again over onto Sam in the duo lane, putting this Medusa that much further behind.
There's a beautiful play coming out from Zetasphere and Mojo Cat, showing a little bit of synergy. Zetasphere hitting that cripple and stopping Medusa from being able to dash away, Mojo Cat crashing down, and ultimately, when the purification beads came out, when the dash was used, it just wasn't enough. As Booty Call Jones and Vartrix, or Varix right now, on a kind of standstill for this Fire Elemental, I think Booty Call Jones was not only able to get it, but they're going to let him leave with his life.
Yeah, I mean, there's just no way to take him down without burning a couple of ultimates, and I don't think they want to try and throw that much at a Xing Qian. He's very tanky already in this early stage. Picked up that Mark of the Vanguard, second item. We're been seeing this a lot from the junglers now, especially mostly from the Assassin junglers being able to pick up something like a Blue Stone or a Death's Toll on top of Bumpa's Mask with the cost reduction, but with this very tanky Guardian jungle, picked up that Mark of the Vanguard second, and the Sunder being thrown.
I feel like that was not necessarily a little PM throw out, but Booty Call Jones just kind of daring typical Java to come forward, try and fight at this point in the game. Varix now having to sit and watch as his speed buff is being done. Mojo Cat going to get aggressive, but the silence coming out from Nox will save her teammate away. But speed buff is still being done right now, and Muffin is not able to confirm it. Actually going to get taken down, and the ult is used. Sueno going to be able to pick up the kill.
Yeah, Muffin finally falling for the first time, playing these Zeus, pay for his transgressions. Mojo goes into the sky and goes down onto Sueno, teamed up with Exterminator, but Sueno's going to be able to walk away for free thanks
beautiful
to the clutch Kefri ult.
That was exactly what you want and exactly what you had mentioned. Harriet Sylvia Bear using that res, being able to pull Sueno back out of that devastating fight, and kind of stop St. Joseph's. If they had gotten that pick, it would have given them more control. Right now, Sueno's staying alive. He will be able to hold his lane a little bit longer, and that might just save that tower.
My man had that res hovered over Sueno, because the millisecond that boulder hit, he was res. He had that ready to go. That is what you want from your Kefri, is the clutch revives. Zetasphere being ganked over in the duo lane, forced to go into the ultimate. He's going to fire his first, second, third shot, trying to connect onto Sueno, but his ultimate's a little bit off the mark. Zetasphere, however, is not going to be able to walk away, and pays for his over-aggression.
A good gank coming out from University of Massachusetts, and the meditation being used, saving the life of Sam. It looked like it was going to be a turnaround, but once that meditation was popped, there was no chance of him falling. And really being able to pick up the one kill, allow that hunter to farm. He's sitting two levels behind right now. With this wave, he should be able to go up, and maybe another kill as Booty Call Jones getting a Greston pulled in. But ultimately, he's a Xing Qian, he's tanky, he should be able to walk away.
Yeah, especially with that, as we mentioned, the Mark of the Vanguard on him. He's going to be able to have that true damage mitigation, taking away 5 from every tick. He's going to be able to tank up minion shots. He's really going to be able to negate that damage from Kefri, as that Rising Dawn is dot-based. Every single one of those dots is going to be negated. Going to use that washing machine to pick up Soviet Bear, who gets flung into the minions. The second jump is going to connect, and Booty Call Jones is going to get a 2v1 kill onto the enemy support.
And right now, it's leading 3-2 in favor of St. Joseph's. They now have a 2,600 gold lead, 2,700 experience sitting on their side, and they're going to extend that a little further as Exterminator picking up another solo kill. Almost fell himself, but he was able to pick that up, and this is going to be something akin to what we saw last game. He should be able to steamroll. Varix going to get the teleport. That should be a kill, but the tower pull and the damage might be enough to get a return kill. No, the last tower shot's not going to proc onto him. Varix is going to be able to get out.
great heads up play by Varix to make that rotation over and take down Exterminator, getting not really the shutdown bonus, but because Exterminator was able to pick up that kill ahead of time, worth a little bit more gold. So great heads up play by Varix. Did not need to use the ultimate there. Great by him to not throw that one away for no reason. But looking over into the mid lane, there's really no jungle to be taken right now. All of the major camps, aside from one Harpy camp, is down at the moment. But over in the duo lane, it's trouble.
Forced to use the res on himself, Soviet Bear is getting away with barely any of his life there. Had to revive just because of the gank from Mojocat, and Mojocat being able to stop the back. He's not going to let you back under your tower. In fact, he might not even let you go under your tier 2, as Mojocat getting very aggressive. But right now, with the red buff spawn back up, I feel like he's going to turn his targets to farm up in the jungle.
Oh, Sam trying to take this boxing match at level 7 now compared to level 9, but there are still minions there, and that's not going to go in his favor. Meanwhile, over in the solo lane, gank over onto Booty Call Jones, and Exterminator is going to be able to pick up a kill for Typical Java on that Nox, who's currently actually sitting just barely ahead of Muffin on this Zeus right now.
Yeah, it's going to be, I want to say, just the real reason that their team might be able to stay in this right now is going to be on the back of Typical Java. If he can help bring his team up with him, he might be able to help find the victory here with the Doom Orb, surprisingly enough. That's an item that I've seen kind of sparingly in the last couple of months, but being picked up, I mean, that's going to be a little bit of extra damage, and when he gets it fully stacked, it's going to be a lot of extra damage.
Ooh, solo kill by Zeta Sphere onto Sam. He was not able to get that Petrify off in time. Zeta Sphere is going to walk away cleanly with that one. A 3-level lead, and taking a look at the net worth charts, he's sitting at 5,300 gold, over 3,900. 1,500 gold deficit between the Hunters at only 9 minutes in the game.
A fight over the speed buff is going to go the way of University of Massachusetts, as they're able to run away with that speed buff. And a nice route from Harriet Soviet Bear might be able to stop him. Fear No Evil going to cause a spread out on the side of St. Joseph's, and Exterminator going to get taken down. But it looks like Booty Call Jones will get out. Mojocat going to use that teleport, and Muffin here going to be able to get the Chain Lightning, get a little bit of extra damage down. But ultimately, I don't think he wants to be in this position.
No, Suedo in a bad spot here as he's trying to 1v1 against Muffin, but Varix has shown up, coming out a few auto attacks into it, but Muffin's ultimately going to get the kill on Suedo, and Varix is going to trade his life. Mojocat picking up one of those makes it a 2-for-2 exchange. Honestly, in favor of St. Joseph's.
Muffin, if he had gotten out of that alive, that would have been insane. He was so close. One more auto just slightly earlier than that, a little bit more damage would have spelled the difference in his life. But St. Joseph is still coming out on top. And honestly, there was something in that last engagement, like just before that I saw in relation to Muffin. We saw Mojocat, he ulted, landed on Muffin just to use the meditation and save him from Typical Java's ultimate and keeping him alive, allowing him to come into that next fight. And I think that play kind of led to what left him alive. Is Typical Java going to get sniped 1-2, but not 3? And Zeta Sphere with no mana going to go into a 1v1.
But Mojocat has come crashing down, is going to stun out Sam, and Zeta's going to walk away by the skin of his teeth. Another clutch and perfect rotation by the support player Mojocat, who I think he heard us talking a little bit of smack about his Thor. Had to show us that it's still a thing.
And Exterminator going to be walking away with a blue buff around his belt, but Suedo not going to try and let him get away for free. Varix, I think, for the first time, not having to fight anyone to confirm his speed buff there. He's able to pick that one up, but the Oracle Heartbeats have been taken, and the Gold Fury is at 1/4 of its health bar, and the Zeus ult's down. I expect to see St. Joseph's be able to pick that one up, no problem.
Yeah, the Fear No Evil's going to come crashing down, and Mojocat is going to perish to Varix thanks to the pull from Harry Soviet Bear, able to drag him just a little bit further away. So it's going to be a one death for the Gold Fury, and that's the support player. Ever since Season 0, that's screaming worth.
And at this rate, the way that St. Joseph's are going, I actually like the fact University of Massachusetts is holding on a lot better than they did last game. But right now, St. Joseph's still have that advantage, and we're about to see another solo kill. Suedo just a little too tanky with the rotation of Varix. That's going to force Exterminator to fall back. He just saved his teammate. The heal coming out will save Exterminator from falling, but Varix was almost able to turn that around.
Ooh, the overhead smash canceled out by the driving strike, and the boulder is going to put him at critical health. Typical Java is making a rotation over, and this is now two people who have rotated over just to save their teammates from Exterminator. Meanwhile, he's sitting still pretty at half HP.
I like the fact that we see St. Joseph's with that rotation coming over. I mean, Gold Fury is down. They don't have much to do, but they're pushing the waves. We actually see Booty Call Jones. He walked into the jungle to check any buffs he might be able to take. And while they might not be able to push down the mid-tier tier one, they are going to be able to fight as the ult coming out from Booty Call Jones, but none of his team is around to really act on that. And Sueno going to get forced back. But ultimately, that was, I want to say, kind of a waste.
Textbook rotation from Mojo Cat's going to get another kill onto the Medusa, and Vart tried to rotate himself over for the counter initiation, but did not go his way. Harry Soviet Bear has made his way rotation over as well, but it's not going to do anything. And this Medusa is just getting farmed. 0-5-1 at the moment. Still has not been able to finish off that Transcendence, as nearly a 3,000 gold deficit between the two hunters right now.
And it's looking like Zetasphere wants to extend that as far as he can. They will be backing off right now, but that's probably to spend some of the gold that they have earned since the last time they backed. Lazy back in the lane, not going to get canceled out, and he will be able to walk away. And Mojo Cat looking like he's going to get chased down, but Tickle Java not fast enough, not going to be able to find the route, not going to find anything. Ultimately, they're just going to have to farm, and Oracles are up again. Mojo Cat's sitting in the neighborhood, but University of Massachusetts should have this one.
Ooh, Mojo Cat getting collapsed on four members, but he's so tanky as a Thor right now. Not something you would think to say, as one ultimate has been expended, but it's not going to do anything. Sam, bad spot. They're waiting for the res to clean off before they take him down, and indeed, he's going to fall. Exterminator picks up a double kill on the rotation. Root's going to stop Zetasphere in place, but Sueno is caught in between it. The Ching Chen washing machine's gonna pick up two, and the boulder's gonna pick up the third unofficial triple kill for Exterminator.
Four kills, not quite a deicide, but enough to give them another advantage right now. Oracle's gonna get picked up by Zetasphere after that, and really after all of those kills, they're all feeling a little bit happy being able to push down the tier one in mid. That should be a free set of gold for all of them, and ultimately they could keep pushing for the tier two with the respawns coming up on University of Massachusetts. It might be a little bit too dangerous.
Fortunately for them in that last fight, pumping out so much damage into just Mojo Cat, their support Thor, who has, as you can see, he's building into tankiness, has the Mark of the Vanguard, has the Sovereignty, is working towards that Heartward Amulet. They expended so much to kill Mojo Cat, and they still didn't even get it then. So a wash of a fight for them as they lose four. But Zetasphere caught in between three of them, forced to go into the ultimate. One Snipe, two is going to connect onto Sam and take him down, and Zeta is just walking away barely. Soviet Bear needs to be able to hit the root onto Zeta to confirm this kill. Sanctuary forced away, but the overhead smash is going to confirm it. Varix picks up that one.
We're seeing Sueno once again get pushed down under his tier one. This time we're going to see Mojo Cat come crashing down, confirming the kill there. Exterminator going to be able to pick that one up. And that should once again be another tier one right here on the right-hand side of the map, as Muffin and Booty Call Jones going to be able to run Varix out of their map, as well as push down Typical Java and Harry Soviet Bear.
Great route onto him, but it's not going to matter. Muffin's going to be able to kill the kill onto Varix there. Booty Call Jones taking a good chunk of damage from that Doom Orb on Typical Java. We haven't seen any major aggression towards this Nox, and if he goes unchecked, that Doom Orb is going to start swinging come towards the late game.
Right now, we see all the members, really, of University of Massachusetts are trying to farm back up, try to find themselves a way back into this game, sitting down 9,700 experience, 8,000 gold at 15 minutes into the game. And really, right now, I can feel it. What they really need is a Portal Demon and a Fire Giant, but with the way the team fights have been going, they have to do it pretty much on the back. Varix has to hit the perfect Fear No Evil, and it has to be accompanied with a lot of damage, and really, this damage is looking like it's coming out of Typical Java, looking like it might be coming out of Sueno, but there's no ADC for their team really sitting at 071, still level 11 right now. Sam falling very far behind.
Hasn't even been able to stack up that Transcendence just yet. Gold Fury going to be going free over to St. Joseph's, as Mojo Cat doing a phenomenal job stalling them on that Zeus. Varix Angus has been used. The res from Kepri is going to be enough for now, but Mojo Cat's going to come crashing down right on the spot. Takes down Varix and gets the double kill onto Soviet Bear.
I like the patience coming out of MojoCat there. He went into the air initially thinking he was going to be the one to confirm the kill, seeing the res, patiently waited until it came through, and ultimately is able to come out with the kill right there. Booty Call Jones is going to be taking a little bit of damage, not caring too much because he's a Xingqin. He is just tanky enough to kind of sit here. And honestly, if more members of University of Massachusetts continue to group up around him, that's just going to be a big setup for his ultimate and possibly turn into even more kills. They're going to back away here. They're going to have to sit under this tower as Booty Call Jones is going to blink in. Sam, nice purification, going to keep him alive a little bit longer, but he's just too far behind at this point, not going to be able to live through the entire onslaught.
Booty Call Jones going to fall because he took too much damage from the tower. Support player is going to be picking up that one. Exterminator missing that pluck on the backhand side. He's not going to grab Nox, but is going to be able to shove Varix out of the team fight. Great root silence by Tim Kujava is going to be able to possibly try and pick up the Exterminator, but the meditation from him is going to keep him alive for a little bit longer.
Sueno having to force the fight just because the wall was good. Boulder going to come down, get a little bit of extra damage. Sueno going to dash away. Harriet, Soviet Bear getting low. Detonate, not enough damage to find the kill, though. He might be able to get away, but a beautiful pluck from Exterminator and the last auto going to be able to get that kill. Roma and Victa come crashing down. Sueno looking for something, but ultimately going to find his death. And right now, two kills down, and no one really to fight. Typical Java, the only one who can kind of stand, I mean, anywhere, but he's getting sniped down by Rom.
Yeah, Exterminator taking up quite a few shots of that Phoenix there, but doesn't matter. He's a Hercules. He can do what he wants. While Zetasphere is trying to push down the left side Phoenix, three members forced to rotate over to stop him, but it's too late for the tier 2 tower in mid as it's going to fall, and MojoCat is finally going to back. He was a part of that team fight almost front to back on there, was forced to ult away, still stayed in the area, however, tried to min-max as much as he could if he was needed as support to come back and provide that stun with the wall or to get that spin to win if necessary.
21-9, read the kills, and the lead just keep on stacking up. 14,000 gold now in favor of St. Joseph's being able to get those last tier 2s, as well as picking up 15,000, sitting a little under 16,000 experience right now. And that's with no level 20s on the board. And I'm going to go ahead and say a ton of that is in the difference between the fact that we have Harriet, Soviet Bear, and Sam here on this Medusa and Kepri sitting at level 12.
How is Booty Call Jones still alive? Has been sitting in the middle of four players this whole time, jumping around in circles, going to hit the Sunder onto Java, but is finally going to fall. Sueno is going to pick up that kill while Varix is forced to run away.
Now Varix is going to be able to get out with his life here, but being able to pick up Booty Call Jones, I mean, at this point, he's really tanky. He's 2-3-2. Honestly, he's not the target you want. He's not the one who's causing so much trouble. I'm looking at Zetasphere. He's the one that you want to kill. Of course, we also have to give a little bit of credit to Exterminator right now, sitting at 8-2-1 and causing the most disruption as Zetasphere is soloing the Fire Giant.
That is a disgusting Hercules right now. 8 kills to his name, has the Shield of Regrowth, has the Wing Blade, has a lot of HP to his name, and that's just going to mean he's that much harder to kill. MojoCat going into the air, crashing down onto Varix as he is stunned in place, cannot run away, and Muffin is going to get the credit for that kill with UMass on the retreat.
Well, we mentioned his name, and Exterminator doing exactly what you would expect to see him do at this point, level 19, as this Hercules is going to be able to get Sueno. Forced Eagles rally, trying to get away. Zusel going to come down, get some detonate charges down. Not enough to find the kill, but enough to force Sueno out of this fight and causing enough disruption. Again, Exterminator, he is tanking this Phoenix like it is nothing and forcing all the members of the University of Massachusetts to fall back.
Ooh, good thing that that root did not connect, because that could have spelled disaster for Exterminator. Instead, MojoCat going to be able to tank that one away. And Sueno gets yanked yet again, forced into the back, caught in between four. The boulder plus a few more shots is going to get Exterminator his ninth kill of the game.
Harriet, Soviet Bear going to fall down. That's 10 kills on the back of Exterminator. Fear No Evil was used, but really to no avail other than to maybe save Varix's life as he gets under the fountain here. Titan going to be aggressed on. We do see Zetasphere a little bit too low to continue his aggression, but Booty Call Jones is just standing there, knowing that anyone who leaves is going to be in his domain. They're going to cause the fight. Varix going to try and do anything, but he gets poked out way too soon, and this Titan should be falling. Sitting here at about 21 and a half minutes, is just slowly but surely taking down.
Ooh, the Medusa ult from Sam is actually going to deter it for just a little bit longer. Likely a Titan still to fall here. Teleport coming out onto Muffin is going to be Zetasphere popping his way in here. Muffin picks up Varix. Mojo Cat's in the sky. He's going to come crashing down into the Titan room. Still trying to finish this one off. And eventually, it is going to go the way of St. Joseph's University.
Now it's still slowly but surely getting ticked down. A good defense. Honestly, if Sam had been a higher level there, that could have been the difference in the world. But being level 13, 21 minutes into this really spelled the difference. They're sitting at 09 and 5. You said it earlier, but he was just farmed as that Medusa. Mojo Cat and Zetasphere took complete dominion of that lane very early on, forced him out twice, as well as picking up a couple of kills on him, just destroying the ability for him to farm early on, and he just fell so far behind and wasn't able to find anywhere he needed to by the time they hit the late game.
Mojo Cat, I'm sorry that I ever doubted your Thor. Your jungle Thor may not be the best, but I'll give your support Thor some credit. You had some hot moments there. I'm sorry I ever doubted you. I'm sorry anybody ever doubted you. St. Joseph's University come out with that commanding second game, 27-12 this time. Saw some light for UMass Dartmouth, but unfortunately that light was not strong enough, and St. Joseph's going to be able to pick up the second game and the first set here at the AVGO College Smite League. UMass, it's not over for them. They still have a long road ahead of them. They still have 6 or 7 more games to complete, depending on their division. If it's 8 or 9, I have to recheck onto that one. They still have a long way to go. They still have potential to get that number 2 spot to move on to the gauntlet. In the event that they have to go against St. Joseph's later on in the future, what do they need to do in order to try and take them down?
I mean, the first thing is they need to prepare Sam to go up against Zetasphere. Right now, the skill difference between the two really is what kind of is glaringly obvious. The rest of the team, and honestly, even late game Sam, they fit in very well. They were holding their own for quite some time, but St. Joseph's, they were just able to farm a little bit better overall. And I mean, ultimately, the fact that they held their own against as strong of a team as St. Joseph's is very impressive. I expect to see maybe a little bit more practice learning how to farm, kind of move together as a unit, keep Sam alive, maybe get him more into some comfort picks. The Medusa didn't seem to work out as well as they wanted to, but they're definitely in contention for some of the top teams in their division.
Surprisingly, Typical Java did a pretty decent job on this Nox this time around. We were very questioning of it in the early portions, and he was able to get quite a bit of damage off, was hitting multiple root combos in order to put out quite as much damage as he could. Unfortunately, he was going against 3 gods who just don't care about damage. Hercules just says, all right, I'm gonna heal it back up. It's Xing Chen, so naturally he's just gonna heal it up with his passive. And then Mojo Cat, he's just like, ah, whatever, I'm just gonna get away from it. So not the best team comp to go against this Nox. But he did the best that he could, especially with that Doom Orb going up so early. He never really had any major aggression towards him, so he was able to farm it up. And if we could have gotten into the later stages of the game, he could have been a devastating threat against St. Joseph's, but unfortunately did not make it that far for him.
Yeah, swap the events at the end there. Have Typical Java be the one alive as opposed to Sam there. Could have spelled not necessarily the end for St. Joseph's, but at least the saving of the Titan and extending the game a little bit longer for University of Massachusetts. But ultimately, they are the ones to fall. Their team, they look really strong. They just have a little bit of work to kind of get through, especially when it comes to team fighting. They did a lot in that game, but St. Joseph's was just able to kind of dominate in every area that they tried.
Looking like a strong team for contention to go up towards that land spot. Mojo Cat, as we said, was the runner-up last time around for the Season 2. Did not make that victory as he lost out today to Remember Squad, but looking very strong in his current division and definitely a land potential with the performance that his team has come out with today. Fortunately, that's going to do for this set. It's going to be a 2-0 victory for St. Joseph's, and we're going to be back in a little while. We've got a bit of a gap difference here between our next set, but we're going to come back with you as soon as we can for our second set of the game. My name has been J-Mac Tucker. Along with me has been Gore Miser, and this has been the AVGL College Smite League, and we'll be back as soon as we can.